So just to talk in detail about the two tests that we use to identify people with kidney disease, eGFR and urine albumin. Okay, so chronic kidney disease essentially means fewer functioning nephrons. Each kidney has about 1 million nephrons, which are the filtering units, and they tend to be lost one by one. So we have a lot of extra kidney capacity, and losing even a significant number of nephrons is often not associated with any symptoms. You know that you can donate a kidney, which is 50% of your nephrons, without any significant adverse effect. If there were an adverse effect, people wouldn't be allowed to donate kidneys. So we have this large physiologic reserve, and most people remain asymptomatic until often until more than three-quarters of kidney function is lost. And that's very significant because if you're trying to educate patients, you're often talking to them about something that's very scary, although they have no symptoms, and they may not be happy about that. So we assess kidney function by glomerular filtration rate. So the way I explain this to patients is that the kidney is a filter, like the filter you put in a truck, but it's not one big filter. Each kidney is made up of a million filtering units, a million nephrons, and they tend to get damaged one by one. If we can estimate how well the kidney is filtering, we can get a rough idea of the number of functioning nephrons. If the GFR is 50% of normal, that suggests that about 50% of the nephrons are still functioning. So how do you get an intuitive sense of what the glomerular filtration rate is? Well, the cardiac output is approximately 6 liters per minute. So your heart pumps 6 liters through the aorta every minute. About 10% of that goes to each kidney. So about 20% of all the cardiac output goes to the kidneys. So that's about 1.2 liters per minute. That means the kidneys are very vascular. Now, what gets filtered is not the total blood, it's the plasma, which is about 50% of the blood volume. So 50% of 1.2 is 600. So there's 600 milliliters of plasma flowing to the kidneys every minute. Now, not all the plasma can be filtered. If that happened, then you'd have 100% cells left in the small blood vessels in the kidney, and they wouldn't flow. So well, only about 20% of the plasma gets filtered, leaving, you know, 80% still in the small blood vessels, maintaining blood flow. So 20% of 600 is about 120 milliliters per minute. So that's where you get sort of a sense of what normal kidney function is. Now, we don't measure GFR except in research settings. It's very difficult. So what we do is we estimate GFR, and we use an equation. And the most widely used one is still the what's called the modification of diet in renal disease, or MDRD. And this is the equation right here. Now, looking at that doesn't do much for most people except remind them how much math they've forgotten since high school. But the key thing here is to look, the equation has four variables, and so that's important. eGFR is equal to the serum creatinine times the age, these exponents are obviously modify that, times the using gender and then race. Now there is a newer equation which is a little bit better, which is called the CKD epi equation, but it doesn't fundamentally change anything, but it uses the same variables. So it's important to remember that this is an estimate of GFR. It is not the measured GFR. And we've been very successful in promoting the routine reporting of estimated GFR along with the serum creatinine throughout the U.S. And in fact, Indian Health Service was the first major provider of healthcare, national provider of healthcare, to routinely report estimated GFR with creatinine, and that was 10 years ago. But the eGFR, the estimated GFR, is not the measured GFR. It's based on a formula that's derived from population-based studies, and you should really think of it as a good estimate of a patient's risk for having actually decreased kidney function. So the way these are developed is they have a study population which for some reason is getting a measured GFR, which is a laborious, difficult process, and then the results of that are analyzed along with clinical characteristics or demographic characteristics of the patient, and through regression analysis, an equation is developed using variables that are commonly available, and they develop the equation which gives the closest match to the measured GFR. So what that means is the estimated GFR that you get on your lab sheet is probably a pretty good estimate of the actual GFR in maybe 100 people who have the same age, gender, race, and serum creatinine. But the individual who's sitting in front of you probably has a GFR that's somewhat different. And the operating characteristics for these equations is not very narrow. So you should really think of this as, remember, it's an estimate, and it can be affected by other factors. It's much better than looking just at the creatinine, but it's still not perfect. And and that's why it's important to be careful about labeling people with kidney disease simply based on a GFR, a one GFR that might be a little bit low. Okay, so the way we explain GFR to the patients is to say that this green area above 60 is normal. Well, that's not really true. Normal is 120, but the equations don't function very well up in this range, so you can't distinguish GFRs above 60 from normal, so that we say normal. 15 to 60 is considered chronic kidney disease, and below 15 is called kidney failure. Some people with GFRs below 15 need dialysis, and some are able to continue to function without it. So the other thing that's quite important is that is to remember that there are certain circumstances where creatinine-based estimates of kidney function, whether you're looking at just creatinine or these estimating equations, will give you very distorted results. So you can't use anything based on creatinine in people who are generally acutely ill, particularly people who have changing levels of creatinine. For example, if you have someone who has normal kidney function and for something tragic happens and they lose all kidney function, if their creatinine today was 1, tomorrow it'll be 2. If they show up at the hospital tomorrow and they draw the blood and it's 2, they'll plug that into the equation and they'll get back some number. You know, GFR is 45. Well, actually the GFR is 0, but the creatinine is rising, and so it doesn't give you an accurate indication. It also, because creatinine is affected by muscle mass, it's a metabolite of muscle tissue, people who have extreme amounts of muscle, bodybuilders, or people who are very cachectic will have creatinines that don't necessarily reflect their GFR. So you need to be quite cautious about using creatinine-based estimates in patients who meet any of these criteria, including almost all hospitalized patients. There are medications as well that interfere with the secretion of serum creatinine by the tubules, and Septra is one of them. So I'm going to encourage you to think about distinguishing decreased kidney function versus kidney disease. because estimate equations are less reliable at higher GFRs, and because kidney function declines with age, there may be older people who have decreased GFRs who don't have anything else to suggest an active disease process. They have no albuminuria, they have no hypertension, they may not even be diabetic. Those patients, you need to be quite cautious, because in some settings, if they ask to look at their lab results, they'll see, GFR 55, patient has stage 3 kidney disease. That's an alarming news for them to receive, and it may actually be unnecessary. They may or may not have something that is a progressive disease.